Hi, my name is Luke Carty and I'm a member of the field engineering team here at Semmle. This video is about writing a QL query to find sensitive or personally identifiable information, so-called PII, that gets written to log files at application runtime. Today we'll be looking at an open source e-commerce platform called Shopizer. It's written in Java and we'll be trying to see whether we can find any PII vulnerabilities in Shopizer. Now, in order to do that, we're going to need to find a way to identify personally identifiable information in the source code. Unfortunately, Shopizer, as with many applications, doesn't have any sort of semantic markers in the code that tell you what is PII. So what we're going to do is we're going to start off by writing a heuristic query that selects all fields in the program whose name matches either email percentage, credit card percentage, or percentage phone percentage. This percentage here is a wildcard character. Basically, we're saying here we're looking for fields whose names begins with email, begins with credit card, or contains the word phone. If we run this query, we can see we get 56 results, including some very plausible looking results for credit card number, email address, and telephone number. So this is great. So this looks like we've got a good start to a heuristic query for identifying PII in Shopizer. As the second step, what we're going to do is we're going to refactor this query slightly to create a QL class to represent it. Essentially, this is giving a name to the set of results we just found, and the name here is going to be PII field. See, the conditions are the same here. And if we run this query, which just goes from PII field select F, we can see we get the same 56 results. Okay, now we've got a good query for PII fields. What we want to do is we want to write a query that finds logicals in the program. Well, fortunately, there's a standard library that we can use here called string format that provides a class called logger format method. And this represents the set of all SLF4J logger methods in the program. What we're actually interested in here is the arguments to calls, known as references in the library, to these methods. Now, if we run this query, see we get 977 results. And again, if we click through these results, these look to be the kind of things that we want. Okay, now we've got the building blocks for our query. We can go off and look at writing what we call a taint tracking query to identify places where the PII information flows either directly or with modifications to a logger call. The way that we do this is we can write a query here. We import the string format library we had before, but we now also import a taint tracking library. This taint tracking library, the way it works is that we define a taint tracking configuration. So the taint tracking configuration has three unique pieces of information. It has an identifier, unique identifier here, PII config. It has some sources and it has some sinks. Essentially what we're asking the library here is there a flow path from the source to the sink with or without modification? In our case, what we're interested in is accesses to our previously defined PII fields. Those are our sources. That's the sources of information here that we want to know whether they flow. And what we want to know is whether they flow to the arguments, to calls, to logger methods. So this config gives us that. Now we can write the query itself. And the way we do that is by choosing the config, data flow nodes for source and sink, and a field. And what we're going to say is that according to this configuration that we defined, find me pairs of sources and sinks where there are flow between them. And then what we want to say is that this field is what is being accessed at the source. And we have this here so that we can write it into the message here. And then finally, we select a location in the program. So we're going to report, in this case, the sink, the logger call that is logging PII information, and a message. And this message here has the name of the field that is being written to the log. Now, if we run this query, we get 8 results. If we have a look through these 8 results, we have ones for telephone number, email address, credit card number, and so forth. So far, all we've logged is the sync itself, the logger call, and the field that is being logged in that place. But it's hard to verify this without seeing the actual flow path between the field and the logger call. So we can make some small modifications to our query. We import data flow path graph, we modify it to a path problem query, and in the fromWhere select here, we modify our data flow nodes to be data flow path nodes, and the config to use has flow path. This means that we keep the paths associated with the flows, not just report that there is a flow. And finally, in the select, we report the source and sync. Now, if we run this query, we get the same 8 results, but if we select these results, you can see we now have an entry in this path explorer in the top right. If we expand this path out, we can see, for this case, we have a field telephone. We can see that this getter, getTelephone, is being called, and the result is being appended into message log string, which is then being passed into this logger debug in the final step. So this one looks valid. This email address result, similarly, has the same pattern. The field is being accessed, the getter is being accessed here, stored in message log string, and then passed to logger debug. Now, if we look at the credit card number result, we can see that the path is a little bit more interesting. Again, you've got the access of the field, you've got the getter, but instead this time the credit card number is being passed to a utility called mask card number. Now this masks the first 4, everything but the first 4 and last 4 digits of the card number. So it's a bit debatable whether you consider this to be sufficient sanitization, but for the sake of argument, say that you do. Then we can actually make a modification to the query in order to add what we call a sanitizer. So a sanitizer essentially stops the taint tracking algorithm when it hits one of these nodes in the data flow graph. And in this case, what we're going to say is that we're going to consider as a sanitizer any argument to any call or reference to a method whose name begins with mask. Now, if we run this query, we can see we now only get 7 results. Then the credit card result has gone. Now, there's a number of ways we could modify or improve this query. We could definitely change our set of keywords here. We could expand this to find more different sources of PII. We could even use some code-based specific semantic markers or names here in order to identify PII for a specific code base and tailor that query for that specific code base. I hope you found this interesting. If you'd like to try out this query on an open source project, you can use our open source platform, LGTM, to run the query and find results, and to run other queries as well. Thanks for listening.